Hello, everybody. Happy Mardi Gras. So to start the festivities, we have a special guest tonight and a special edition of Forum. So Billy O'Connell is going to talk to G, and then the last 20 minutes or so, we'll open it up to questions. And when you, if you would like to ask a question, please come down and use that mic or this mic, which we'll put here. So are you ready?
Yeah.
Well, so let's say, what should we say? Welcome, G. Here we go. One, two, three. Welcome, G.
I have illegal water. I have illegal water, yeah. Apparently it's illegal.
Man, this is nicer now.
It's like the most beautiful IKEA room.
I remember it being bigger. Ever.
Yeah, it was bigger actually. Yeah. No reflection. I think you've welcomed Gerald already, but let's hear it for G-Eazy. Well, we're awfully darn proud of you. You know that.
Thank you, Billy. Thank you.
Let's cover kind of present state, right? Mm-hmm. Current situation. What's the deal? You have a record that's basically number three in the world. Mm. A pop single, it's basically number three in the world. And as a friend of mine told me, the only people you haven't beat so far is Bieber and Adele.
Yeah, the song's doing really well. I mean, it's new for us. Like, this is like 11 or 12 years in the making. I got started when I was a freshman in high school. Me and Marty right there, like we would like every day after school, take the bus to my house. We saved up our money, got a microphone, had Pro Tools. Like that was what we put all our money into. Like we'd record songs, upload them to MySpace. I'm showing my age right here. My gray hair too, that's kind of crazy. And burn CDs, I bootlegged Photoshop to be able to like design mixtape covers. Would sell them out of my backpack. Came to Loyola. I was not gung-ho on school, but you know, I was like, all right, fine. If I'm gonna do anything, it's you know, related to the only thing I care about.
Did your grandmother make you come?
Yeah. And Snyder.
Grandma and grandpa.
Yeah. and then getting here and like being cooped up, you know, in Beaver Hall like all day, like, you know, all I did was make music. And 318, who's ever.
I was gonna say, what room so that someone, anyone in here? Beaver 318? No.
Yeah.
It was actually.
Yeah. Get it popping, man. Who's ever in that room better? Yeah, get it popping. and having nothing react. I mean, like, nothing react. Like, you know, we would play shows, like, Republic would book us, like, all the time. Yeah. We'd play shows, and a couple hundred people would come, or whatever. Like, you know, but it was real slow, but it was just like step by step, continuously. You know, recording, putting music out.
And also pivoting, right? Little changes, incremental changes along the way, right? Nothing was, you know, locked in and you know, you were making observations, right? You're making little changes to what you did, right?
It was about being a critical thinker. but anyway, we'll get back to that. But
and you'll never be dropped.
What I'm saying is like, you know, for all these years, and even as it started to pick up and, you know, the touring and the last album was like a first tipping point that these things happen. But this is my first time with a hit, like, on my hands. And it's crazy. It's growing into something completely. It's got a life of its own now. That song's going, so.
Well, that's interesting because that's one of the things I wanted to talk to you about. The idea that you can't plan to have this happen. Mm-hmm. You can... No. The distinction that I've been making with kids today, literally kids today, like we have this admissions day going on, many of them are probably here. We're talking about the fact that you can't plan to have a hit.
Mm-mm.
You can plan to do everything you can do to stay in it for 11 or 12 years.
Yeah.
And if you can stay there, paying the rent, feeding yourself, getting by for 11 or 12 years, 15 years, 20 years, you can stay where you are. Cranking it out, and maybe you have a hit.
Yeah.
So what I think we...
It just can't be contrived. Like, at the end of the day, there's no...
It's not a formula.
There's no formula to it, man. And it's got to be honest and it's got to be real. And, you know, when it goes, it goes. And the interesting thing is like what a hit can do for everything else. It's like a missile or like, you know, it puts everything on its back. Yep. You know what I mean? It's like, yeah. That's what's taking everything to a higher level. It was crazy, but, you know, there was such a foundation there from the start.
Let me ask you a question. When you have a hit, mm-hmm. it casts a much wider net. Yeah. You go from having a core following and fans mm-hmm. to reaching people who...
Only know that song.
They only know that song. Yeah. They are brand new to you. Mm-hmm. What kinds of... preparations, what kinds of planning are you doing to try to take advantage of that wider net for retaining?
Yeah. The back catalog is important, you know, because for everyone who discovers, it's like, okay, he didn't just come out of nowhere and just get lucky and, you know, have this one song take off. It's like, okay, you can dig into my catalog. Like, you can go back and hear the old work. It's still all out there. But I don't know. The thing is like it, I guess was the song is like it's gotta be you, you know, it's gotta like represent like who you are honestly. Like I always said, like I would hate for a song to take off that didn't like, you know, that I didn't feel like I could like write another one or that didn't represent me and my brand and who I was honestly.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Because it's like it casts a much wider net, like you said. So it's like all these people, you know, you got to give them you. And it's hard because it's like there's so much, you know, to me. Like, what do you fit in 3 minutes and 30 seconds to give them a pitch of who you are as a person or whatever? But.
Yeah. Well, how about that? You touched on the idea of brand. Mm-hmm. What do you, you know, when you say brand.
Brand was something I want to talk about because it was something, you know, we talked about here, mm-hmm. us here, like again and again and again. And the importance of the word brand. And basically what it is like your identity. You know what I mean? To the world. Like what separates you from the rest of the world? What makes you you? What do you stand for? What do you represent? What do you look like? What do you sound like? What's your story? You know what I mean? Why should people care? And well, all that goes into brand.
Lately, I've been talking about brand as synonymous with trust. Mm-hmm. So what does it take to trust somebody?
Yeah, and that's brand loyalty. Like for people to keep coming back again and again and again, like, I meet fans that like have been to like 25 shows, mm-hmm. and that's crazy, but it's like you could lose that trust in an instant if you ever broke your brand,
yeah.
if you ever broke your identity and what you stand for. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's like, it doesn't matter how tired I am from, you know, that day's schedule or the shows the night before, like 10 shows in a row without an off day or whatever. Like if I'm traveling to a city, if I have an event, if I'm talking to people, whatever, like they don't care about what happened last night in Orlando, they came here, you know what I mean, for the show in New Orleans tonight. And you have to give it your all and always be you and never slack because it's like they don't care what you're going like. Yeah. So you gotta always like, you know, and that, the same thing. It's like with an album or a song or even like a feature verse or something like that. It's like the second you break that, mm-hmm. you know what I mean, and slack is like when you let people down and you start to lose that brand loyalty of like, you know, if you were like a Coca-Cola person and some, like, you know what I mean? Like you went into the store and you bought a Coke and it started tasting funny and it just dropped off, you know what I mean? You wouldn't be a Coke person anymore. You'd start messing with Pepsi, you know what I mean? So it's like, you're like, yo, I'm gonna jump over to this side. It's the same thing, it's like.
And not for no reason, it's because you'd stop trusting that Coke was gonna be what you rely on it for.
Yeah.
And that's the issue, that idea that your identity, that your style, your who and what you are, and the mm-hmm. quality of work that you turn out.
Basically, always go hard, never go weak.
Yeah.
Basically, in all things you do, always be a beast.
Yeah. Right on. Amen. I'm always trying to be a beast.
Always.
I try.
Always.
So, how about team? You know, put a team together over the years. Now, you started with that guy.
Yeah. Shout out to this guy right here in the real cool shirt with the glasses. That's Matty B. I met Matt when I was a freshman. I was in Beaver pissing off all my neighbors with my monitors, my studio. And my roommate also made beats. And he was smoking with Matt, and he said, you know, you got to check out my roommate's stuff. Like, he makes music. He's a rapper. And Matt heard it. And then there was a talent show here at Loyola that I got booed off stage at. And he saw me get booed off stage at that talent show. It was like later that day after my roommate put him onto my stuff. And he saw me, and he was like, that kid's going to be Elvis. Straight up. So I always say he was either psychotic or he was a genius.
You know, he could be a psychotic genius.
Yeah, psychotic genius. Yeah. There, we got it. We got it. But no, the importance of team is this. Like, you can't do this alone. You need great people around you in every position. Like, A players want to work with A players. A players get A work out of other A players by, you know what I mean, inspiring each other. It takes a solid team. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you can only do so much alone. And the other thing is, like, the culture of team, mm-hmm. like what you guys are about. Like, we've always been very critical in a good way, you know what I mean? Like, critique everything. We're never comfortable. So it's like, instead of just trying and just being happy with everything, it's like everything gets revisions, even our tour videos that go up on YouTube. You know, every you know what I mean, flyer for a party gets like revisions, like, oh, make that font a little bigger, move this aside. Like, every song, the mixing process is like, I want to kill myself because there's so many, like, mixing an album, like, I lose my mind because I get so particular about, like, you know what I mean, where the kick sits and, you know what I mean, like, what, like, every little sound. But just, like, that culture that you stand for as a team, you know, it spreads out to everyone on the team. They adopt the culture that you stand for, so.
Well, you know, I want to dig a little deeper on that because it also matters who. And how do you select who the right people are for you? And what you base that on. And just like brand equals trust, equals, yeah. You know, what you are, the work you turn out, the way you do things, the, you know, I think that what we always talked about here was core values. Mm-hmm. You know, how you know who your people are, how you know yeah. Your, you know, who is going to work best with you yeah. To build the best thing so that your enterprise self-directs so that yeah. Your business drives itself, but you're making left-right decisions, you know, little pivots here and there, but you're not keeping people on task. You're not scolding anybody. Mm. You're not trying to impress upon anybody why they have to be on time or do their job or that they work as hard as everybody else. You know mm-hmm. What I'm saying? You know, what did you do to articulate that idea?
I mean, we definitely fired some people, you know, everybody didn't last. But that's
yeah.
That's
so, in general terms, why? What makes it so that something doesn't work out?
It's core values. Yeah.
Yeah.
And there's just certain things that you can't teach. Like, you have to have in your bones, in your DNA. Like, you know what I mean? Like, work ethic, attention to detail, care. Like, bottom line, like we care, like, so much, and that's like what like drives us crazy and makes us insane. And like keeps us up at night, you know what I mean? And like whatever, but that's why, like, why we're proud of what we've done and why we stand behind it or whatever, but we just care so much, you know what I mean? And if you don't care, like, that reads. You know what I mean? If like, if you don't care, then you don't care.
Yeah, well said. So from here, so, you know, you're at this point right now, you're riding a wave.
Yeah.
Right? And you're trying to get the most out of it that you can get out of it.
Yeah.
Kind of preparations are you making now for keeping it going?
Yeah. One thing I would always say, and I still stand behind, is like the work you're doing today, you might feel the benefit from like 6 months to a year from now. Once you get to like a, you know what I mean, like a cruising altitude level. So to say, like, 6 months ago, I was in the studio finishing up the album. You know, like, and I'm in a room with no windows with my phone on airplane mode for 6 months straight, like, working. You know what I mean? I would only ever leave. I played a lot of festivals and stuff. So I'd fly out and come right back to the studio. I was locked in. And it was like a lonely process of like, I'm making this music, but I'm the only one that's heard it. And Matt and like the immediate team. And it's like, I'm sitting on this. I wanted, you know, back in the day, I would upload it to MySpace tonight, you know, but you know, you would prepare for the next step. And then, okay, you put the album out and then you tour. So you always gotta think, like, you know, waves come and go. Like, this, the highs will come down, you know what I mean? Like, this song is booming right now, but like, okay, so what do you have to follow it up. Yeah. You know what I mean? Right. So every time we thought we were done with the album, we had that in mind. Like, okay, what's the second single? What's the third single? Because if Me, Myself, and I does go, you know, you got to have legs to keep going. Yeah. And then even those, like an album will ride you so long, but it's like attention spans nowadays with the Snapchat generation are so short that it's like they love you today and forget about you tomorrow, like straight up. So there's a studio on the bus, like, you know what I mean? We're always thinking about like what's next.
Yeah, and you have to be able to bring value after value after value to these people because, you know, those people, let's say, these people, they'll stick with you no matter what. But those people, because really, they have a selfish motive. You're doing something. You're providing them an experience. You're bringing them a state change. Right? Yeah. When they hear your music, something in them changes. It shifts. It's great. It changes their chemistry. Mm-hmm. And when you stop doing that for them, or if you stop doing that for them, you're of no use to them anymore.
Yeah.
Right. So that's the kind of thing that keep you up at night.
Yeah. Absolutely.
But it's also the kind of thing that can be so much fun. That's the fun of the work, right? Yeah. To be so curious and so creative and energized, right? It's an enthusiastic exercise. Can you speak about maintaining the enthusiasm for it?
I mean, this is all I've ever loved.
Yeah.
Like, since I was 13 or 14, I really decided, like, you know, I fell, like, head over heels, like, in love with the idea of, like, making music. Like, and if I was, like, all right, if I'm going to do it, I want to be great. Period. I want to be like a top tier rapper. Period. Like, I want to chase Jay-Z. I want to chase Eminem. I want to chase the greats. Like, you know, and that's just perspective. Like, everybody who looks at the world that way doesn't necessarily land there, but it's your perspective.
Right.
So it's like at the end of the day, there's just a drive, you know? Yeah. And there's no plan B. There's no fallback. Right. Like, there was no like trust fund to come home to or something. My mom lost her job. She moved back in with my grandma.
Yeah.
Like, she couldn't pay rent. Like, there was nowhere to go. So it was just like, this has to work, period.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, and the fans, like, the thing is, there's a difference between like the fans that come with the like, the song that's blown up right now and then the core, you know?
Yeah.
I wanna have that core forever. I wanna be the Grateful Dead.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And
yeah.
tour. Cause I love the road. I do enjoy the road.
Yeah.
I would love to be able to tour until I was Willie Nelson's age, you feel me? So.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd just be turning up, just an old ass man.
So let's talk about something else that I've admired about the way you went about your business.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people work to the point that they get some attention from the powers that be, from a gatekeeper of some kind.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Right? So you know where I'm going with this, right?
Mm.
You know, you got your music heard to a point. You attracted the attention of an industry.
Mm.
You were getting calls. You were being flown out to LA. You're flown into New York, right?
Mm.
And, you know, we always talk about this idea that you were able to say a credible no.
Mm.
At those times, you knew what you wanted when you needed them, when you didn't need them.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea that when you were offered a deal and you said no, it was clear that you had enough going on independently from a DIY standpoint that you meant no.
Yeah, basically, VR,
until they could bring you what you needed.
We drew a line in the sand, and it was like, you know, I'd been flown out by labels when I was actually here, and it didn't work out, you know what I mean? And truth be told, I wasn't ready anyway. But that just put a sour taste in my mouth of like, you know, all right, well, fuck the labels. I'm gonna build this myself then.
Yeah.
And we did. And it was like, these things happen. I wasn't signed. I recorded the whole album myself. I shot those videos on my dollar. Like, we were making like $30,000 a month on TuneCore from the last album. And I had saved all that up. We had like 120 grand. And I put that, we shot our own music videos, the Far Alone, Almost Famous video, the Let's Get Lost, like that was paid for on our own dollar. Like, we had that money, we bet the house on it, I believed in the album, so when the labels came and they wanted to do that album on a major, you know, I was like, bitch, no, I built this shit. Like, my album is served on a plate.
Yeah.
It's ready to go, it's ready to buy. You give me what I want, or we don't have a deal and I go next door, period.
Right. But so is there a more credible no than that? Like, you know, you know, no, and I mean no.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So the idea that there did come a time when it wasn't just a case of being signed so you could be signed. It was why be signed?
Why?
What's in it for me?
Well, and honestly, man, like, and speaking to y'all, like, there's just there's different avenues, and right now, man, the power is truly in the hands of the creative and the people. The people dictate what works and what doesn't. You know what I mean? We don't live, you know, the powers that be don't have as much power anymore. Yeah, I mean, right. The magazines, like print is dead. Like there's no MTV, there's no music. You know what I mean? So it's like all that's left is radio. And I will say, like, honestly, for real, like radio still matters. It's crazy to me. Like, but what radio's doing for my song right now is what, like, but that's to say, you know, you look at artists like Chance. Chance decided, like, period, I want to keep it independent. I want to be organic. I don't want to major. And he's done extremely well for himself. Like, he's got a great business model. He's very, like, his relationship with his fans is like mine. It's very core. It's very, like, organic. It's very, like, you know, and he could be the Grateful Dead. He could tour forever, you know? And, like, we have the same kind of thing, and we could have just stayed there. Yep. And I was just like, me personally, like, I saw where we could take it here, and then I saw, like, I've always wanted to be a star, period. I've always wanted to be, like, the biggest thing in the world. And we were like, okay, if we do decide to do a major deal, these are our terms.
What do we need?
Yeah, what do we need?
Exactly.
No 360.
Yeah, right.
Period, because we built this touring.
Marketing money.
Marketing money and creative control. Right. But in all honesty, man, it's like you just got to set where you want to be, because it's really in terms of, like, if you can get music to react and start to bring money in and save it up and reinvest it and bring money in and save it up and reinvest it and build your touring organically and keep releasing music, then you don't need a major. Honestly, we probably would have better terms if we would have just went to some rich man if we could find one and just borrow $1 million and just do it that way.
Yep.
But at the same time, it's just about establishing which avenue or what.
Well, and finding a partner who has a network, you know, that, yeah, you know, you can build your own network, but radio's
really
expensive.
The last thing. And it's expensive. Very expensive.
And that's where, you know, we've talked in classes, you know, obviously there's an awareness of what you're doing, and we'll talk a lot about the idea that, first of all, radio really matters. Mm. Secondly, when you build a business like yours, you were a startup, right? You built your business to be a very big, privately held company. There came a time when what was right for your company was to IPO.
Yeah.
And a major deal is an IPO.
Exactly.
Why does a company IPO? A company IPOs when it needs more money than it can get its hands on to grow its business and to grow its brand and to reinvest, you know? And, you know, yeah, it sells itself. It sells itself to the public.
Yeah.
And
I saw
it
as a tipping point.
Exactly.
I saw we had a tipping point on our hands. Right. With these things happen, and with the lead up, and with the content, and with the music, and with everything. And I was like, do you want to bet big or do this organic? I think if we would have done it independently, who knows what we would have sold first week, but like we wouldn't have done 50K.
No, because there's certain things you need their reach for, certain things you need their money for. And as I said, the money isn't just money. The money comes with reach, it comes with a network, it comes with promotion as well as just dollars. And it, to me, it seems like a strong analogy between you know, your business and signing when you need to sign.
Yeah.
You know, I know a couple of artists lately who did the same thing. They brought it to a point, they were ready, they could demand what they wanted and get it.
Yeah.
And then they had access to the money that they needed to grow the brand. And if you're going to be a pop artist, money.
Yeah.
You need money.
Yeah.
You need the kind of money that, a rich man can bring you, but a rich man couldn't bring you the network.
No, the network and the whole label staff and everybody who's there to do what they do in their field and stuff.
Right, right. So, you know, I'm awfully pleased that we can point at that and show that only by building to that point as a startup, by bootstrapping and by being, you know, maniacally focused on your product and building your customer base, you could then point at that and say, now grow me.
Now,
I'm ready. So... we want to take some questions for you.
Yeah.
Were you guys told how to conduct yourselves for questions? I guess we need clothes to be kept on and no body parts will be signed here.
Well,
no body parts will be signed here. How do we want to do this? Forming lines at the mics? Well, what about
first
what
off, shout out to all of y'all for coming on a Saturday. I do appreciate that. That's love.
Over Mardi Gras.
Yeah, Mardi Gras. Man.
Over Mardi Gras. All right. We also have, we also want to bring Maddie B up here.
The brain.
Here's Pinky, that's the brain.
I'm Pinky, he's the brain.
All right. Maddie B. Matt.
Is this thing on?
Matt, before we start taking questions, anything that you'd like to add? You know, I think that that you know Gerald alluded to your working relationship and kind of how you guys put your plan together. But is there anything that that you'd like to add to the conversation? I know you're awfully proud of the achievements right now and what's going on. You want to talk a little bit about that, maybe?
I think it just comes with a lot of communication between us. I'm partially like a gatekeeper that, or like a filter that kind of filters out.
Buffer.
Yeah, the bullshit that he doesn't need to deal with.
Yeah.
But also just, you know, him and I are so connected with that kind of stuff that I know, you know, which flyers he's not going to be down with, which brands we don't want to associate with.
Yeah.
And just kind of, you know, having just such a close dialogue about the brand and what we want it to be.
Yeah.
And stuff like that. And then another thing y'all touched on that I wanted to touch on was just having the product be insanely great and, you know, revisions, revisions, revisions.
Yeah.
And like we, you know, like our video team, they constantly film and we constantly do revisions. They'll set their alarms, wake up at 6:00. We can make a deadline to nudge the one frame over of the tour announce video.
Well, it's really being a critical thinker. And that's what, I mean, a principle that y'all would talk about, like, and I didn't really know what it meant at the time, but like that being a very important principle. And what it really is just like, you know, critiquing things, like not just accepting everything, but like thinking critically and always thinking that, you know, it can be better. It can be better. Like
total quality management, right?
Quality control.
You're always
attention to detail and quality control.
Yeah.
And there's only so much that can be like checklisted. A lot of it is visceral. Like when you walk around the venue, I'm like, you can feel the temperature. We need to turn the air conditioner on because when the fans get here, like let's not put the little wristband trash on the ground. Let's make everything, everything is a representation of the brand. You know, how everyone acts, every part of it.
Yeah, we talk about the fact that everything communicates. And if you're not paying attention to everything, then you're losing a chance to communicate something. So there's leakage somewhere, right? You can't afford leakage.
And even just like the blanks we get for merch, he had like 8 different hoodies and he's like, this is the only hoodie we're going to use because everything is the brand.
Yeah. Yeah. That's great. Well, how about questions? Anybody want to get up? Yep. Come on up. Come on up. Take his place at the microphone.
Jack
you can
Skellington.
Do the same. Jana, go ahead. Just line up at the microphone.
All right. Cool.
All right.
How do you think that studying in New Orleans shaped your ideas of music or like how to brand yourself or how you came up on stage, like things like that?
I think two things. Half of it is New Orleans is equally as, you know, unique as the Bay Area in terms of like they're both kind of bubbles of culture that are different from the rest of their states. Soaking up a completely different scene and just broadening my horizons, being in the South in general, hearing different, you know what I mean, styles of music. But the other half of it is, honestly, I gotta keep it real. It's like, and this almost saddens me, but it's like, we're growing more and more towards like an internet generation of like, you know, I don't think cities will ever lose their culture, but it's like, you know what I mean? Your culture is defined by like what you curate, like what you pay attention to on the internet, you know what I mean, as much as anything. But then just getting the college experience in general, like, it was completely different than how I grew up, you know, and being in the dorms and, really, what I liked about being here was you're in a community of like-minded people at the same age with similar goals. Like, I met him, okay, he wasn't a rapper, but he wanted to be in the music industry, and we complimented each other. You know what I mean? Like, I would write hooks, and if I knew a girl, you know, on the next floor was a singer, I would be like, hey, can you come sing this hook for me? And we would make music. I would work with, like, if I knew a kid on my floor could play guitar, I was making a beat, and I was like, yo, I think this part would sound good on here. Be like, yo, come here. Like, can you come record this shit for me? Like, just being in a community of people with, you know what I mean, different skill sets, but like-minded goals.
Also, did you ever go to the Boot?
Yeah, hell yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I went to the Boot, Snake and Jakes, The Saint, Republic. For sure.
Hey, what's going on, guys? Thanks for being here. So both of you are clearly very spectacularly effective with your time. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about daily practices, whether that be what you do, but also just what you think about on a daily basis that helps you be on point and just really effective with what you're doing productivity-wise?
I think it's, for me, it's just finding what you want to do, what you want to be the best at compared to anybody in the whole world. There's 24 hours in a day. That's a lot of time. Most people sleep for 4, 6, 8 hours. So that's a lot of time to get done. And like, if you have the passion, it won't, you know, like there's endless time to do what you need to do. And like, I always make the joke that it's like, it's almost, even if we're making a lot of money, it's almost less than minimum wage because it's all day, every day. I'll wake up in the middle of the night, and same with him in the studio, just 24 hours a day. So really, if you're passionate about what you want to do, you'll find the time to get everything you need done. You know what I mean?
Hi. So on your rise to fame, I'm sure you went through some struggles and had some doubts. What has kept you motivated over the years?
Just not having a plan B.
All right, thank you.
Well, part of that,
there's a lot to be said about, there's a lot to be said for fear.
Yeah, when we were going to school here, he used to say, as like an airplane, he's like, the runway's here, the end of it's a cliff.
Yeah.
That's when I graduate.
Yeah.
So the plane needs to be flying by that point.
It's so funny.
I really like, I want to turn up on y'all one time, like, yo, if you're not doing it right now, like, you're crazy. Like, get it popping now, because this does not, like, grow overnight. And I remember, like, in my senior, like, you know what I mean? Like the finishing projects, like, senior year, and there were kids that just, like, wrote their whole business plans about stuff they weren't already doing. I'm like, bruh, get it popping. Like, go do it.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, so start now.
Yeah, we talk about this all the time. This program, the 4 years you're here should be like rolling down the runway the entire time. Yeah. So that senior year, it's wheels up. Not senior year, you start rolling down the runway.
No.
And then you can make your deals with these guys about why you don't have to go to class because you're already touring. And then
we're a lot more sympathetic.
It's not pitching, it's professional, you know, preparations.
Yeah, we're a lot more sympathetic when you got stuff happening.
Yeah.
Okay, so bouncing off the previous question, not just in the music industry, but in any industry, when you have like a big goal and you know you want to get there, I know it's hard because like I'm already starting, you know, every day I have to wake up early, I have to go and I have to grind. But how do you continue? Yeah, I'm bio pre-med, I'm not even music. How do you wake up every morning, like I know you've probably been doing this for a while, and continue to wake up and be like, okay, I gotta do this. Like, what motivates you and what's your like inspiration for that?
Just being in love with the process. Not the return, but the process. Everything that goes into it. Yeah.
Okay. Maddie, can we talk a little bit about goals? About goals?
Yeah.
Goals?
Yeah. Because, short-term and long-term.
Yeah, because setting. I think, you know, when you have a long-term goal and you break it into difficult but manageable sub-steps, right? I mean, then you have something to measure, right? I mean, not to turn this into a class. Look, everybody starts to talk to each other when we talk about
this. Like, say with touring.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, we tried to tour when we were in college. We borrowed your SUV, and we went out. And if you don't know what it feels like to have your legs fall asleep every day crammed into an SUV with 7 people, like traveling with a rice cooker, everyone's got their own Tupperware with their name on it, then you don't know how sweet it is to sleep on a bus if you haven't slept on every friend's floor. But like, we just wanted to tour so bad, so we would say, man, if we could just get 200 people to come a night, you know? And that was after the Vans Warped Tour, we finally, you know what I mean? We went out and we sold out a bunch of like 200 cap rooms. We're like, all right, cool. Now if we can come back 6 months later and we can sell 500 tickets, all right, cool. Now if we can come back and play the bigger room and sell 1,000, I want arenas now, period. But like, you can't just dream of arenas when your feet are asleep in the car, you know what I mean? It's like, it's a big, long goal, so you set, like.
And then you have something to measure, and you can actually read progress.
And when you read that progress, it's inspiring you. That's what inspires you to keep going, is because it's working.
Yeah, if the gap is cramming yourself into this SUV to arena, that's not a gap you can measure progress within. It's too overwhelming a gap, right?
Oh, yeah.
So you need to break it into something that you can see and see your progress, right? So I hope that helped. You grind better.
So, first of all, can I give you this? Because
yeah,
rap game Jack
movie.
Skellington?
Yeah, that's my favorite movie. I kind of look like this guy, don't I?
Rap game Jack Skellington.
It's funny, my son was wearing those boxers.
And us.
He's wearing Jack Skellington boxers.
I'm gonna set him down. Is that
okay? Okay, it's fine.
There you go. Oh no. It's all right, we'll figure it out.
And second of all, what's going on with you and Devin Baldwin?
Oh, you're out of pocket. Mine. My album is really selling really well.
Next!
I just wanted to know, like, do you have, like, a specific songwriting process? Or do you, like, sit down every day? Or are you inspired randomly? Like, how does that work for you?
Yeah. I mean, like, I'll go in with a producer, say, Southside. Like, I met him in Atlanta. He was a total stranger. We became friends instantly. He started playing me beats. You know, I heard the what turned into You Got Me. He skipped it. I was like, wait, go back to that one. I heard it, and I just start mumbling words, pacing around the room until I was like, bitch, you got me fucked up. And I was, and then like, and then my A&R, Gene Nelson, heard me say that. He's like, what'd you just say? That right there, go record that. And it's just that free process of just like walking around a room and mumbling. Everyone's got a different process, but just like, it's gotta be intuitive, and it's just, I don't know.
Hi.
Hi.
Reflecting back on your journey through the music industry, is there anything you would have done differently? If so, what?
I wanted to push Far Alone longer before we got to I Mean It, but that's kind of small stuff. But I mean, it's like he said earlier, it's a pivot. You know, you're not on like a rigid course. As soon as you see something working, oh, okay, this is what's working, we're going this direction now. So I think, yeah, just being super aware of what you're doing and being super hard on yourself.
That's the thing. If you're not self-aware and humble and, like, reflective on yourself, critical of yourself, and it's tough because, like, to be a star, especially in hip-hop, is so ego-driven. It's so, like, you have to, you know what I mean? Like, you have to feel yourself. If you're not a confident rapper, who wants to, you know what I mean? Like, you know, so, but at the same time, like, and it's hard to feel yourself when 30 people are coming to a show and you just hopped out of a borrowed SUV. So it's like it's a balance of being extremely self-aware of the long term, but also like having the confidence to believe in yourself and do it.
Thanks. Hello.
Hello.
Okay, so I want to work in the film industry, not the music industry, but I know that both are extremely difficult to find the endurance and motivation because the odds are against you. And it was already asked. But other than not having a plan B, did you have anything that made you keep going?
I mean, again, just like, I'm in love with doing it. I'm not in love with doing it because I want to get rich or whatever. I just like, you know, and I say that to say, like, don't get me wrong. I wasn't just comfortable like, oh, I'm just chilling here doing my thing. As long as I can pay rent, I'm good. I very much wanted it. But at the same time, like, but anything else, like, unless you're just born a prodigy like Mozart and you can just, like, you know, like, wake up one day, you know what I mean? It's like, it's going to take a long time. So you just keep pushing yourself to get better.
Well, you know, what does Snyder always say? That profit is a byproduct, not the point, right? It's not the point of it. It's a byproduct.
Where'd he go?
Where is he? Oh, there he is.
Bada bing, bada boom. That's it.
And yet... Profit is also incredibly important, right?
Yeah, I mean, profit's really cool.
It allows it to continue.
It's very cool.
Beyond being cool, it's also vital for you to be able to continue, right? And if you can't continue, you can't find the time to get the hit, right?
So a lot of that is reinvesting.
Exactly.
Is if you're not always constantly reinvesting in what's next, then...
Yeah.
I think the same kind of question has come up a couple times, though, in terms of like how you stay motivated. But I think if you haven't found what's motivating you and getting you up every day, like obviously it's not like, oh, I just want to go to school every day, but I'm going to school to better my situation, to meet the right people, to become the best this. So it's like if what your passion is, like if you haven't found that, I would keep looking. You know, it has to wake you up every day and be like, I'm going to go be the best in the world at this. And obviously, there's steps to get there. So if you start as like a production assistant, like I used to do out here on video shoots, and that's not what I want to do, but that's what I needed to do to get where I wanted to be. I would, you know, like, and don't wait for people to tell you to do stuff. Like, as soon as he's like, go wrap all these cables, I'm then sweeping the floor, taking out the trash, and, you know, don't wait for people to tell you. Take the initiative. And, like, you know, one of the things, like, with that is one of my old bosses, he's like, I'm going to fire that guy. And he's like, you didn't tell him to do anything. He's like, I got to tell him what to do now, too. Like, you got to figure it out. You know, go figure it out and just keep yourself busy and do it.
And the basics, little things, showing up, being on time, you know, doing more than is expected of you, right? I mean, it's decency, it's grace, it's being able to sort of be different than 80% of the people.
Thank you.
Hey, I would like to say it's like very dope to see you here, because I remember sophomore year just like homie playing out of pocket and like Must Be Nice and all the endless summer. So that's really dope, and just to see you grind, and then just to see from you even like to top SoundCloud from our freshman year here, and then talk after that, and then to see where you are like an album later, two albums later, it's really dope, and like I appreciate that. Like I don't know, just being a model. So yeah,
for sure. I really, really, really wanted to come back here and do this. And I'll keep doing this, because it's like, I just remember like sitting where y'all are. Sometimes I would sneak out. But not like just wanted
rarely,
to like.
Rarely, rarely.
Rarely, very rarely.
I
went to every school. But like, just like, you know, wanting to like, sometimes like, you know, people from, you know, like my age range or genre of music who could like, you know what I mean? And I just like, I feel y'all, cause I was right there. You know what I mean? So I always like, you know.
So I know you've been in our position before, and we're part of like an independent company called Dolawant. So we want to just give you a few Dolawants.
For
sure. Hope you roll a Dolawant.
Yeah, for sure. Hold on, what is it?
Rolling tape.
Oh, for sure, respect. Yeah. For sure. This is great. This is great, great presentation, great branding, marketing, great packaging.
Ladies and gentlemen, our students. Awesome. Woo!
Hi, nice to meet you. So to kind of quote one of my favorite rappers, and I'm sure he's probably one of your favorite rappers, Jay-Z, do you agree with the statement that when the further you get into the industry, you only get better? Like, because I know a lot of people like may say that, a lot of people may say that you're not as good as you used to be. A lot of people like kind of criticize rappers for changing over time. Mm. But do you agree that you only grow so that you can change, or that you only grow that so yeah. that you can get better?
Well, I mean, like growth, like evolving, like everything is natural. But the thing as an artist is there's two things to consider. There's technique. Like just your actual like, you know, your pocket, your like your wordplay, your, you know what I mean, like things as a rapper, like, or you know what I mean, like the production quality. So there's technique, but then there's perspective, you know. And the thing is, like, people get mad at artists like if they feel like they've changed or something like that, but your life changes naturally, like your experiences, everything you go through, and all that finds its way back into the music. So there's like a couple things at hand. There's just like, you know, your honesty as a person and your perspective, and then there's the actual just like mathematics of the technique of your craft. So I mean, technique is one thing, like, you know, whether you're a basketball, I mean, sports analogies are really corny, but I'm about to make one. Like if you're a basketball player, you know what I mean, you got a million coaches in your ear telling you exactly, like, you know what I mean, your footwork, your steps, you're like, well, how you move in this situation, you're constantly working to better your technique at whatever your craft is. Same thing as if you're not like doing the same thing as an artist and like, you know, going back to your old stuff and critiquing it and wanting to get better, what's the point?
Excuse me. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Hi. Okay, so I'm in the fashion business, whatever, and I know network is, yeah, it's whatever. I know that networking is really important, so if you could kind of talk about like the middle where you were still in college, but before you signed on to a label. I just really admire that you did independent stuff, and tell me, like, what were your favorite ways of networking, or the best ways that worked to network?
I'm not exactly sure what you mean, but like networking in terms of like who you collaborate with.
Right, and like who you make connections with.
Yeah, well, it's gotta be like-minded people who see the world a similar way as you do. There's a company called Brooklyn Circus, it's a clothing brand, and they make really awesome varsity jackets. And they got this like mid-century, like old Ivy League kind of like aesthetic to it. And I just liked them as a brand naturally, because they kind of like were a similar style and aesthetic as what I was on with like Endless Summer and like slicking my hair back in that era of like the Runaround Sue video and shit.
Right.
And I went from being a fan of them to like growing a relationship with the company to now they produce all my merch. You know what I mean? And they design it, but it's about finding like-minded people. Like, you're really defined by what you say no to, not what you say yes to. And just like meeting people that make sense. Like, I won't do a feature for everybody. I don't charge when I do features. I do them all for free, but I gotta do them for people, you know what I mean, who I like actually like fuck with musically, like, you know what I mean? It's, you gotta, so like when you're working with people, like networking in any situation, it's not about just saying yes to everybody who gives you a business card. It's about like, you know, are we even on the same page?
Mm-hmm. I think something important with networking too is that what a lot of people kind of do wrong. You meet someone at a party, you're trying to give them your CD, you're trying to give them your SoundCloud link right off the bat, but it's, you need to develop that relationship first, just become friends with them, email them the next day, follow up in 6 weeks and be like, hey, how you doing? Like, let's meet up when you're in LA. And like, I think the thing where a lot of people go wrong is just trying to jump to the offer or the ask right away. And like, oh, like I met him, give me a verse, here's my beats. But like, just become friends. And like, if they fuck with you, like you said, then they'll do it, mm-hmm. You know? So just nurture the relationship first.
Also, last time you were at the Republic, you said you can't wait to perform in the Dome. And I definitely think that's gonna happen real soon.
Hell yeah, for sure.
Hey, how's it going? I actually have two questions. Is that cool?
Yeah.
So, what's it called? So, like, a couple weeks ago, like, Wiz Khalifa and Travis Scott dropped Bake Sale using the exact same beat as Order More.
Yeah.
So, like, how does that work?
Well, I mean, this is just like a, you know, a runout, kind of like how the industry works sometimes. Like, producers got to eat too, you know what I mean? And you set up a studio session with a producer. He'll play you a bunch of beats or whatever, maybe give you a drive sometimes, like, you know, and the turnaround time is such that, like, you record a song, you know, it sits. I did like 50 songs for this new album, you know what I mean? Not all of them got selected to be on an album. So if a song that I did never got put out, that producer, he should go give it to somebody else, you know what I mean? And then sometimes that limbo is where it all gets caught up. And basically, like, he had given the same beat to them. That was the last song I did on my album. So the night I cut it was like the day before we turned our album in, damn near. And I cut it. I was like, is this still available? He said, yeah, turned the album in, bought it, all the paperwork. But we're in a weird space right now of like internet and how songs like can pop up, you know what I mean? Somebody plays it at a show, somebody videoed it, it's up, you know what I mean? That live rip, and now the song exists. It's not like the old days where it's like the label had it on lock and it came out on CD and vinyl and that was it. So it's like, you know, it happens. Yeah.
And then, so like a lot of rappers and artists and whatever, they'll sort of make it to the top with like one producer. So like Macklemore, Ryan Lewis, Time Flies Tuesday and all those guys. Mm. Were you just not trying to do that? Or?
No, I mean, like Christoph is Anderson, who also went here. Did most of the first album with me and helped out with the second one. I'm also a producer in the sense of like, I don't make beats anymore hands-on per se, but I got started as a producer. When I was at Loyola, I was, you know what I mean, like making beats in my dorm room like all day long. So it's like, I say that to say, when I go in with a producer, like I have the vocabulary to say like, here's what I'm looking for. You know what I mean? So, cause I definitely do think having a cohesiveness of sound, like defining, you know, what are you looking for? What do you want to say? What do you want it to sound like? The texture, the mood, the vibe. So it's like, I'm a little bit different. I don't just say, man, play me some turnt up shit or something like that. You know what I mean? I'm like actually like in there with producers, like talking about sound, talking about tempo, talking about feel.
Well, that's a theme that we talk about here a lot, which is that you know, you need to know a little bit about everything,
mm-hmm.
You know, a lot about some things, but so that you can have relationships built on collaboration, not dependency.
You can get more out of people.
Yeah.
If you know a little bit of their vocabulary. Like, he's not a lighting guy, but when we did Fallon, he's over there like telling the guy exactly like what we want out of it because he has enough vocabulary to describe.
Yeah.
And I'm like, this is who this guy is. We're on Fallon and he's bossing around the lighting guy. Like, that's amazing.
That's great.
Thank you.
Hey, G, how are you?
What's up with it?
Okay, so whenever you first started like putting out your music and stuff, like what was your like best marketing tactic that you had to like build a fan base and keep it sustained?
Keep it free for a long time. That's just the day and age we live in. And social media, yeah. And I mean, I don't know. It's like, it's just crazy being back here. I remember I put out a mixtape like on a Monday and then came that night to Music Forum, and a girl like standing right where you were, her name was Brooke, she told me, "Oh, I love your new mixtape." And I was like, "Wow, that's crazy. You heard it?" Like, but you know, yeah, just making it free, like making it accessible. So making it everywhere, because it's like some people, they go to YouTube to listen to music. Some people go to SoundCloud. Some people go to Spotify. Some people, they like to buy music on iTunes. Some people like to go out and actually find a hard copy or whatever. So it's just like, you know, if you make yourself too hard to find, yeah. Nah, you lost me. I'm sorry.
Be findable. Be everywhere.
Be everywhere.
Right? You have to be. You can be. It's easy now.
I think it's also a mix of having a strategy, like we always talk about, but also kind of going back to the pivot is not overthinking it and be like, everyone's going to think this, so I'm going to wait, put my mixtape out 5 months from now. It's like, no one's going to think anything because nobody knows, you know? So, you know, just developing the product so it's amazing and it grows legs on its own. So when you make it accessible everywhere, it speaks for itself.
Thank you.
Hi. How was it working with, how was it working with,
don't be nervous,
Chris Brown?
I'm just like you.
And, what's your ultimate dream collab?
Man, Chris, that was one of the ones I was actually not in the studio with him. I had met him a couple times or whatever, and I did another song with him that never came out. It had a ratchet ass name, it can't come out. But I remember being in the studio when he sent the files over. And the first time I heard it, like, I had pure chills. Like, somebody, I mean, because it's like, even it's weird now, like, I don't know. But I always consider myself a, like, an independent, organic, like, homegrown, like, underdog artist. I don't think of myself as, like, you know, like, on these people's radar, you know? So when I meet them and they know who I am and they show love and I hear them on the same song with me, it's just mind-boggling, and I was just like, wow, my life's about to change. Like, he killed it.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Hola. How did your music evolve? Like, what took place to make your music evolve from, like, Candy Girl to Me, Myself, and I? Like, what took place with it?
Man. I mean, again, like I said a second ago, you evolve as a person, and you evolve, you know, obviously technique, just, you know, getting better at everything about making music, you know what I mean? So, yeah.
Thank you.
Hey, okay, so I have a kind of specific question, but I saw you at Lollapalooza over the summer, which was insane, but I was very impressed with not only how, like, your stage presence, like, how your song sounded live, but also the transitions in between the songs were so clean and just, like really, like, you put on a performance, not just kind of, like, got fucked up and then...
Yeah.
Just, so, like...
No, thank you.
Yeah,
because that's something I've studied, like, everyone. You know what I mean? Like, all my heroes, like, I go to shows. You know, when I'm at a festival, I'm like, one of the coolest things is you get a wristband to go. You know what I mean? Because I remember sneaking into Voodoo, like, and just being like, you know? So it's like, I go watch everyone's sets. Like, I love music. I listen to music all day. Like, I go watch people's shows. Like, but the thing is, like, you got to know how to steal.
Yeah, and you're watching, you know, with a selfish motive.
You watch What's in it, you know what I mean? Like, both, you watch and admire, and you also watch, like, ooh, that was really cool how you did that. I'm going to try to incorporate something like that into my show. One of the early ones was Lil Wayne. Like, I was still going to school here. And basically, his partner, my other manager, Jamil, who went to Dillard, got a gig assistant tour managing Lil Wayne. And this was right after Carter 3. And he kind of, like, slid me onto some of those shows. No pay or nothing like that. I just got to open up, like, 20 minutes after doors open, I'd go on and do a 5 or 10 minute set. And it was a learning experience for me, but more so, I got to watch Wayne's show every night. Mm-hmm. And this is when, like, Wayne was the biggest thing in the universe. And he's, like... He's one of the greatest ever, period. But he's so great at performing. He's a rock star. Yeah. And his talk breaks and transitions, and it was so clever and so witty and so cool. So it's like, I mean, I've studied everyone. Like,
yeah, that's great to hear. Like, you're awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. So Run Around Sue was, like, the first song I ever heard from you, and I was just wondering if you still, like, on the side, like, fuck with flipping, like, old 50 songs.
Yeah, then the next project I'm gonna do is probably Endless Summer 2. Yeah, I want to go back and do another one like that and just flip a bunch of over. One thing I've always been about is just like bridging gaps. And that's kind of just me as a person. You know what I mean? Like in a literal sense coming from the Bay Area. But the Bay Area is a very diverse place culturally. And it's like, you know, in terms of music, taking something, you know, from decades ago, mm-hmm. but it's just a universal story. So you just halftime the drums and, you know what I mean, rap over it and tell the same exact story. But bringing worlds or subcultures or eras or genres together, you wouldn't think.
Thank you. That's so exciting to hear, by the way.
Hi, I was listening to your new album earlier, and like the song that like struck me was What If?
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of like struck me like, what if like your career didn't pan out the way you wanted it to? Like,
mm-hmm.
what would be your backup plan?
Oh no, I probably died somewhere along the way. This is just happening. Yeah, either that or a really long ass, cool ass dream.
All right, thanks.
I don't know.
Hey, so you talked about the Bay Area being like a diverse culture, and mm-hmm. I was wondering, because I listened to the song Champions with like you, Little B, and all those guys, mm-hmm. are you like planning on to like keep your thing going with Little B or what?
Hell yeah, Brandon's the homie. Brandon is a great soul. Shout out Lil B, man. Like, that's a truly, truly special person. Yeah, really, really. Yeah. I've known him for a long time.
Hi. Was there anyone who really inspired you to make music? Like, anyone specific? And, like, when you were younger, who did you look up to?
Yeah.
That really inspired you?
Yeah. Yeah. When I was real little, when I was living at my grandma's house, my aunt and uncle lived there too, and they were like rock stars.
Yeah.
You know, like they never had kids or nothing, they just never grew up. They were the coolest people on earth that I knew. And they played in a band. And they would rehearse in the basement, and I would sit on the steps and watch them play. They got CDs pressed up. You know, to me, they were like superstars. They like played shows, opening for, you know, bands that were on the radio and stuff. Like they were close to it. And my mom would always discourage me because they say, you know, they spend so much money getting those CDs pressed up, you know, they don't make it all back, like it's tough, like, because you could only go to studios, you know, to record, and there was no MySpace. So yeah, I always like wanted to be like them. And I wanted to be like Mac Dre.
Thank you so much.
For sure.
You're a great artist, by the way.
Thank you, darling.
Hey, what's good, G?
What up?
Like, as an artist, I understand, like, the importance of going into the industry with, like, a mission to try and change and help the collective culture.
Yeah.
And I mean, I'm not 100% like hip with all your music, but I understand and respect your branding. So I want to know if there's any particular like message you try to communicate with your music and your brand.
Well, that's a loaded question. But what you said was important is like, here's the thing, it's always a balance of culture and charts. And you can never like, you know what I mean? It's important to keep. So, I mean, just maintaining the integrity for that and just always being honest. Like this album for me was my most personal album I ever made. I was listening to old Wayne mixtapes. I think it was like Dedication 2 or 3, and it was like he had a skit where he was just like, music is at its best when it's personal, when you're just telling your story. And that just, it jumped out at me. Like I got chills when he said it, and I was thinking like, wow, like, you know, if you're not being completely honest with yourself, you know what I mean? And just, because that's all you can be. You can't tell nobody else's story but your own. You know, your pain, you know, your demons, and your, you know what I mean, your ambitions and your goals and your dreams. And it's like, when you put that all out there and just be yourself, like, that's all you can be.
Yeah, I'm going to go listen through that.
For sure.
Okay. Be real honest with me, okay? Real honest. How many ratchet females do you come across in this industry? Like, be real, because we know, you know, man, that whole thing. It, Chris Brown and that female trying to say he hit, you know.
It gets crazy.
Really?
Like, I was at an after party the other night, and there was, like, three girls dancing on me, like, pushing each other. Like, oh, it got almost violent. Damn. And I'm like, yo, only one of you can really dance on me at once. True. Like, what are you doing? Like, three of them, like.
And, like, you ever, like, did you ever happened. Have this situation where... Bro, Bill's comments be having me dead.
Wait, what?
But no, like,
Has this ever happened to you? Is it real when there'd be like females who didn't F with you before, and then all of a sudden you get famous and they're like, ooh, you look fine.
Yeah.
And then like, all of a sudden they like you, they like your hair all of a sudden, and they just want to come up on you and stuff.
Yeah.
That really be happening?
Absolutely.
Damn. Yeah. These girls be thirsty.
It's all real. The Force is real. The Jedi is real. It's all real.
Absolutely. Thank you.
This is kind of off base, but I'm going to your show tonight, and I got tickets for me and my brother for his birthday. He couldn't be here, so could you shout him out happy birthday on video?
All right, are you videoing now?
Yeah.
All right, happy birthday to brother who I don't know the name of.
Huh? Caleb.
Happy birthday, Caleb. you know what I mean?
Yeah. What's up?
What up?
I just want to say...
You're our last question, by the way.
I just want to say, like... everything.
We got her. She's fine.
Yeah, you're up already.
It's convenient. You're like three rows back. It's fine.
She's up.
Like everything that you said today, like it makes so much sense, and it just so it like inspires me so much more to do more what I love, and it's just really cool. Like just to like coming here to Loyola has just changed my life so much because like you know I just remember it wasn't that long ago when I was just like. Just thinking about like doing music, and now I'm like really trying to do it, and it's cool to see like you actually did it, and like I want to do a song with you.
See, you did that thing where you jumped to that.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, you did it just a little too quick, you know. Just a little too quick.
Wait, are we not friends yet?
Like, Jesus Christ.
Huh?
Are we not friends yet?
By the way, don't ask anybody to marry you on their way out. Don't.
I just wanted to ask you who your favorite up-and-coming artist is.
My favorite up-and-coming artist? Gold Link is really dope. Vince Staples, I don't know how up-and-coming. Vince is already, like, doing his thing. But, yeah, Vince Staples have probably one of my favorite albums of the year.
P-Lo.
P-Lo. Yeah, shout out P-Lo. Yep.
Thank you.
For sure. Neff the Pharaoh. Yeah. And Kehlani, obviously.
Oh, I love Kehlani.
Yeah. Like Kehlani, that's my sis. Like the first time I saw her perform, like this was like a year and a half, 2 years ago, and I just like she's the coolest. That's why like a year ago I hit her. I was like, yo, you're coming on this tour with me. Period. Like I want to just give you all this game that I can. Yeah, but she's doing her own thing, and that's the point. Like, I brought her on that tour, and just like, you know what I mean? Like, we kick it every day, and we just try to like, you know what I mean? Like, pay it forward. Like, anything I could, you know what I mean? Like, help out with it. Now she's flying. Like, it's beautiful. Yep.
So when it's dark out, was there something like what? When did you decide that was going to be the album title? And also, does that have anything to do with the intro and how you connected? Like, Do Not Go Dental into that good night. Like,
yeah.
When did you decide and why?
Yeah, I mean, those are just conversations we had through the process of it. Like, you know, I wanted to go, you know, like in this, like, I wanted to feel like a Batman like soundtrack behind Zimmer or Danny Elfman, like really like, you know, dark music, just in terms of like the texture and vibe of musically, like production side or whatever. And I was just like hashing out the concept of what, you know, I'm big on like when you put an album together, okay, like everything doesn't have to be a concept album, but like collectively, like what do you want to address? What do you want to talk about? What do you want to say? Like, how do you want it to feel? We kicked around a lot of ideas. It was going to be the night album for a while. I'm glad we didn't call it that. It was going to be called Villain. It was going to be called It Wouldn't Stop Out Yet. So we just finally ended there.
Yes, you have some scoring in you in the future, you think?
I mean, I could be like, yeah.
Work when you get it.
Man, if I could work with like a Danny Elfman, that'd be so raw.
Yeah. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Where do I put this?
You can put it on that thing.
All right.
So anyway, join me in thanking Gerald and Maddie for being here. Thanks, fellas.